What is up? Welcome to episode 19 of Etsy Jam. In this episode, we talk about the exciting journey from day job to self-employed entrepreneur. We cover some things that are good to keep in mind about financial planning, keeping your sanity, the roller coaster life of entrepreneurs, time management, and more. What is up, guys? Welcome to episode 19 of Etsy Jam. We are going to talk about today the mysterious healing and cleansing power of Himalayan salt lamps and how they can benefit your workspace and your home.
That sounds fantastic, Gordon. Tell me about this Himalayan salt lamp that's working magic in your house right now.
Yeah, they're actually giant salt crystals that supposedly come from the Himalayan mountains, and they have a light in them, which they attract like dust and, you know, toxins in the air. And
negative ions,
and that sticks to the salt. It stays on the salt, and then it's all happens through the moisture that's in the air, right, that attaches to these things, like smoke particles and whatnot. Then as the light heats them up, the water evaporates back into the air, and all the nasty stuff that you don't want hanging around in your room stays on the lamp, or this is so I'm told.
That sounds pretty interesting. Now, you don't seem all that well informed on the salt lamp, Gordon. So,
well, I'm not an expert yet, right? Like, I just got one a few days ago, so I'm still a newbie, but I'm doing my best to learn.
And fun fact, I actually have one too. I got one as a Christmas gift a couple years ago. It's pretty great. Actually, it's hanging out in the kitchen area right now. I also have some Himalayan salt, which is absolutely delicious, in a salt mill in the kitchen cabinet.
Interesting.
Yeah, Himalayan salt tastes really good.
Is it like different than like a sea salt type taste?
It's very similar.
Okay.
Yeah. Except actually, I was recently via the 4-Hour Chef by Tim Ferriss introduced to another kind of salt called finishing salt.
Never heard of that.
It's made by Maldon, Maldon. Uh-huh. And I found some in the grocery store, surprisingly. And it is actually really good. So it's not the salt that you're going to use to cook with, which they call the working salt. It is the salt that you are going to, you know, put it on the plate and then like sprinkle some on top.
See, I thought you were going to say like sprinkle on your driveway to keep the ice off. And I was like, I don't know, man. I'm worried about you eating that now.
No, that's another salt. As you can tell, there's a lot of different salts that you're going to want to have in your house. You're going to want to have the Himalayan salt lamp. You're going to want to have the finishing salt. You're going to want to have the working salt. And then you're going to have salt for your driveway.
Right.
Yeah.
Is there any other salt they're going to need?
Well, you know, if you have a backyard and you want some deer and other wild critters to come around, you're going to want a salt lick. So that's another type of salt.
Dude, that's a good point. Yeah.
Yes.
Good one.
Yeah. So we're up to like 5 different kinds of salt
I think that's good. I mean, obviously, if you have a saltwater fish tank, they probably have a special kind of salt, like a sea salt mixture that goes in there if you're refilling it with tap water during water changes.
That is a good point. You are going to want that salt. It's going to be a specially balanced salt that's going to be, you know, like right out of the ocean type stuff to give them that that same environment. I used to have a saltwater fish tank, and we definitely had a lot of that salt. So that's definitely a good thing to have.
Now,
desalinate that water because it evaporates, right? Yeah. Salt doesn't actually evaporate, but when the water does, and then salt ends up out of the tank regardless, right? It gets crusted up on stuff, and it happens. So watch that salinity. That's very important. Use your hydrometer.
Yeah.
Keep it within the range. And the once you get past these blue damsels, which are the more hardy fish, you're definitely going to, not to be confused with Gordon Hardy, but they're hardy as in like tough.
Yeah.
Again,
that's what the Gordon Hardy, same thing. Yeah, tough.
No, that's how you can tell the difference. If Gordon were a fish, I'm not sure anybody would be able to keep him healthy in a tank.
What is that one? He's always floating around near the top, like half upside down.
We call him Gordon. So, how about we talk about something we're a little bit more well-versed in?
Yeah, something other than salt. I mean, we came up with more content on salt than I even expected we would, so...
Are you surprised? Because I'm not the least bit surprised.
And I have more to say. I actually do have more to say, but I'm going to leave it. I don't want to get too deep into the salt thing. I think we should talk about something different, something that might be a little bit more interesting.
How about
to our audience?
How about entrepreneurs thinking about leaving their day job to do you know, either a side hustle, what they're currently doing right now on Etsy, doing it full time.
I think that would be a good one. I think that would be a really good one, because I think a lot of people in this space are somewhere in that series of stages in their life, right? There's a lot of people that we talk to who aspire to be leaving their full-time job and to be able to do their shop full-time. We've talked to some people who are working hard right now to make that happen. And we've also talked to people who have made that happen and who are now enjoying the benefits and sometimes the stresses of having a full-time Etsy shop as your primary income. So I think that would be a good thing to talk about.
That would be great. Yeah, let's talk about that. But first, a disclaimer. So, of course, Gordon and I are not legal experts, financial experts, accounting experts. So nothing we say here should be at all construed as anything other than entertaining.
Yeah, definitely we're really not experts in anything. So I wouldn't really listen to anything that we say.
That's probably the best disclaimer. Yes. It would be foolish to listen to us is what we'll say in our disclaimer. Yes.
I think that covers it. But yeah, so keeping that in mind, right? Like while we can't provide you good legal consult in any form, there are some things that we can cover that will make this transition easier for you. If this is in the back of your mind, if this is something you're actively working toward, or if this is a change you have recently made in your life, you know, and or even have in the past, you know, there's some things that we can talk about here that might help you out that maybe you hadn't thought of, and that can give you a leg up.
Absolutely. Now, one of the things, there's a myth that I'd like to dispel, and that is commonly, whenever you tell anybody that you're going to go into business for yourself and stuff like that, people tend to perceive it as very risky, or they think that entrepreneurs are only, to be an entrepreneur, you have to have a huge appetite for risk. So it's always like, oh, are you ready for all that risk, right? Yeah. Well, really, entrepreneurs aren't necessarily risk seekers, like many people believe, right? They aren't actually, a lot of them, different studies have shown that a lot of entrepreneurs are actually more risk averse than most. The difference isn't in their appetite for risk. It's in their belief that they can do this, or there's belief in their idea is a good one. And a lot of them are motivated by, I don't want to get too preachy and call it a higher calling or something like that, but they believe they can make an impact somewhere. The biggest impact they can make is by doing this business, doing this thing, and that drives them. Mm-hmm. But they're not risk seekers. A lot of times, there's people that are terrified by most other risks. They just don't see what they're doing as risky.
You know, it's funny you mentioned that too, because I think back to the very first job I had out of college, and I graduated with a background in computer science. So I was looking for like a programming job, and I ended up working at like a really big Fortune 500 company out in Iowa. And when I left there, I went to a company that was like 12 people. I was like the 12th employee at this little small company. And when I had to make the decision about whether or not, you know, I wanted to do that, I was really nervous about that. I'm like, I was kind of freaking out about the fact that it was a small, small company. And there was just some kind of safety that I felt, you know, working at a large company that had thousands of employees and the benefits package and all that kind of good stuff that they give you there. And going to a place with 12. And I don't know why. And it seems silly now when I think back on it and all the other places I've worked since then. Lots of other small companies, because I ended up really enjoying working at small companies. But I had, you know, this, it was like a fear, like you say, almost, of, you know, going away from something that's a much bigger organization to something a whole lot smaller.
There you are. You're risk averse, yet you made the leap to entrepreneurship.
This is true.
Yeah. It's also interesting the security that people feel in big companies, because definitely people think that. Definitely people think they're secure in that. It's definitely it's been a long-term staple of go find a big company to work for, get in young, work your, you know, 40, 50 years, get the pension, retire. They give you like a watch or something, I hear, and you know, send you on your way and everyone's happy. But that's not, I don't think it's really the case anymore. More often, people are pushed out, right? So I know people in two different situations. I know an older guy, not that old, right? He's in like his 50s, right? So those of you who are listening, I don't think you're really old if you're 50, but you're definitely not, man. Right? You know, you're not early career, like, you know, you're in your 20s. So you're more established in your career and you're getting a higher salary. And of course, they're not pushing you out because of your age or anything like that, right? But they force people into retirement and they find ways around it and they can do that. So I know someone that happened to them somewhat recently, like within the last year, at a big Fortune 500 company. He and a bunch of others had that happen to them. And then I also know of younger people, like in their younger 30s, who are at a company where they're terrified that they're going to get laid off because they see so many others being laid off in that company. Yeah. But you don't really see this all over the news or anything because it's not big news. And it happens. So I just don't see that. The reason I mention this isn't to, you know, put a dark cloud over everybody, but it's to kind of put it into perspective, the difference between entrepreneurship and working, you know, in one of these big companies. There's might not be as much safety in the, you know, the common choice that people think there is.
You know, it's interesting too, because right before we started talking, I mentioned an article to Richie that I had been looking at that was saying how, I think it was 97% of employees in the United States work for a company with less than 500 employees in it. And I mean, that's a huge percentage of people working for companies that aren't gigantic, right? And then even farther than that is almost 90% of employees in the United States work for companies with less than 20 employees in them. And so if you're trying to make this jump and you're feeling like you're alone when most everyone you know is working at a larger company, you're really not. Like, it's really a huge segment of the population who is working for smaller companies. And, you know, if you have an Etsy shop and you have it set up as an LLC or some other kind of actual business entity, you're already one of them. You're already working at a company that is either you or a small team of people.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sure that number doesn't even factor in how many people now, because it's pretty common, work for someone else in a bigger company, but also have side gigs, because it's very common to have side gigs.
Sure.
In fact, the person that came and installed our internet, it's a side gig for him. He's actually an insurance adjuster, like by day, that's his day job. And I guess he came out during the day here too, but he does too. He has two jobs. He's he's employed as an insurance adjuster. And he also does contract work to install cable. So, however, he probably doesn't set up on his own company doing that. I'm not sure. I didn't ask. I digress.
There you go.
All right.
So keeping all that in mind, keeping the disclaimers in mind and keeping in mind what Richie was pointing out about the fact that, you know, entrepreneurs aren't necessarily always like crazy risk takers. There are some things that we can bring forward that may help ease the transition and are probably some things that are good to think about if you're interested in making this move, if you're in the middle of making this move, or if you just did make this move. And the first thing that you're going to want to think about, obviously, and most people probably have already thought of this, is replacing your salary, right? You have some income right now. I assume if you're working a day job and you're thinking about moving to self-employed, you have a salary. And the first thought is, okay, well, I have this dollar amount and I need to be able to create that same dollar amount if I want to have a perfectly smooth transition from where I am now to my self-employment opportunity. And that's not entirely accurate, right? There's some other things you're going to want to keep in mind beyond just that salary figure, right? Your employer that you're working for now, at least in the United States, again, I have no idea how this would work internationally in some other companies. I don't know what like the business and the tax and the benefit structure is in those places, but at least in the United States, most employers are required to provide benefits to their employees, which would include like 401k, medical insurance, stuff like that. So those are things that you're also going to want to keep in mind. And the first one we want to talk about is probably medical.
Yep. And you'll often see this as, at least in bigger companies that I've worked for, they'll show you this type of stuff in what they call a hidden paycheck. So it's like, hey, here's your salary. And then they'll pay, depending on the company, it might cost them up to 50% more than you're being paid in the other benefits and stuff like that, that they're actually paying on your behalf, like part of your taxes and benefits, depending on you know, what you have there, and 401k contributions and stuff like that. And if you work for a bigger company, they're quite happy to like show you this stuff because it shows you how valuable they are to you, right? So take a look for that.
Medical expenses can be pretty high. And I'm not even talking about like going to the doctor medical expenses. I'm talking about the premium you would be paying to have a medical plan available to you, right? It's not a chunk of change to cough at. It's actually a big amount. So before you go ahead and make that jump, that's something you're going to want to consider. Now, if you're married, you might have the opportunity, and your spouse works, you might have the opportunity to go on their medical insurance. And in this case, that's not going to be as much of an issue for you, right?
Yep.
You can just kind of go on their insurance, and their employer will pay whatever portion of the cost that they are set up to pay and stuff like that. But if that's not the case, if you are the primary, financial income for your family, or if you're completely on your own, you're going to need to cover medical insurance. And so you're going to want to look into that and get a good idea of how much to expect to be paying for medical. One of the ways you can do this, if you just want to kind of get out there and do a little bit of research, is to jump onto ehealthinsurance.com, and you can put in your information, and they'll throw at you a list of plans that are available in your area, along with the monthly premium for each of those. So you can kind of get a ballpark figure for what you could expect to pay or have to pay in the medical arena right now. Richie brought up a point before we kind of jumped on into the jam here that you're probably going to want to talk to somebody like a broker or something like that, who's going to help you consult and figure out which plan might actually be the best for you and for your family, if you're covering more than just yourself, because they're going to understand this industry a whole lot better. Of course, you can go out there and educate yourself, but is that really worth your time? Is that really, if you're focusing on entrepreneurship, do you really want to be out there, diging into the guts of medical plans and out of pockets and deductibles and all that kind of boring stuff, versus, consulting with somebody who actually gets paid by the insurance company, so you're not even paying them to help you out here. But that's really their job, is to understand all these different plans and to understand the landscape and position you in a way that you're comfortable with, and a plan that actually makes sense for you.
Yeah. And depending on your situation too, a broker can also, show you with the off exchange. So you might have heard of the health exchanges, the Affordable Care Act and all that, right? So they have these state exchanges where the government funds, subsidizes. So depending on where you fall, income wise and everything, you can perhaps get some federal subsidy there from that option. But they can look at all the different options and tell you really what a good fit is. Plus, at the employer level, a lot of times they will put you in really high cost plans, which isn't normally a bad thing, especially if they pick up a bunch of it. But a lot of times you're over purchased on insurance, right? So it depends again on your unique situation. That's where a broker can really help. They can look at it and say, okay, well, are you managing any ongoing treatments? Do you have anything on ongoing health concerns or anything like that? And get a plan that's proper for that versus I haven't been to the doctor in 10 years, right? That's it's a completely different situation. Why spend a ton of money on premiums if you're not even planning on using it all, right?
So that's a good point too. I think when employers are picking out plans to offer to their employees, they're really trying to find ones that are a good suit for everybody there. So they're looking across their entire employee population and figuring out, what is the best option for kind of everybody, where that, like Richie's saying, that might not be the best choice for you. You might want a plan that's a little bit more affordable than that.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Cause it's coming straight out of your pocket.
That's right. Completely out of your pocket.
So definitely check into that. And again, that can be quite the rabbit hole to go down by yourself. So I'm all for being informed. But at the same time, it's one of those things that you don't want to find out that you made a bad move on when you need it, right? So it's not a bad idea to get some professional advice there. Just like with the next topic, which would be taxes. Again, so it's one of those areas where, depending how comfortable you are there, right? You might not want to spend your time being an expert in it, because if that's not your thing, it's probably not worth your time to keep up on all that. But figuring out taxes is another one that's different, because your taxes, at least in the United States, are going to be different whether or not you are an employee for someone else or are self-employed. And, the income or loss from your current business, you're probably are experiencing that right now. But it does change a little bit, because you won't have withholding if you are set up as a pass-through entity. So there's a couple different options as far as figuring that out. One if you're not that comfortable doing your own taxes, which I definitely don't blame you for, if you're already not doing your own taxes, talk to the person that is already doing your taxes, because they'll have a good handle of your current financial situation and understand what those changes are going to be, because chances are they've dealt with this many times with other clients. But if you are doing your own, you can definitely keep doing that. Take a look at TurboTax, probably the most popular option. You're probably already using the right TurboTax package if you already have a business set up and you're considering, you know, jumping over to full time. So you don't have to make too much change there, but you might want to take a look at what other things are going to change, such as, you know, are you going to be taking more mileage deductions on a vehicle, home office deduction? Are some of these things new to you? You can take a look at TurboTax's TaxCaster. It's pretty cool little site and gives you an idea of, okay, like this is where I think my income is going to be. Now, granted, it doesn't show you the next year. So whenever I use this, it's based on, like right now, it's based on 2015. That's okay. I don't think the tax code is going to change that drastically year to year. So the idea for me is to just use these tools to get close on things, right? Reasonably close, because you don't even know how much you're going to make, you know, in March, right? Or even September, you don't know how the rest of the year is going to go, right? So it'd be silly to try to get to be penny perfect. So you can throw in some pretty basic numbers there and get an idea of what you're going to owe in taxes. And then more than the dollar amount, I try to look at actually the percentage amount, but the overall, not the bracket you're in, but the effective tax rate.
Yeah. So, and just to back up here a little bit too, right? And kind of make sure everyone's still with us and on the same page here. When you get paid by your employer, the paycheck that they're giving you already has your tax removed from that. So your take-home dollars are things you can actually spend. And when you're self-employed, nobody's doing that for you. Nobody's taking that tax money out for you. So it's kind of up to you to understand that a certain percentage of that needs to be set aside so that when, you know, tax season comes around, you have that money to pay to the government. Otherwise, if you spend all of that, they're going to tell you that you owe them, you know, thousands of dollars in taxes, and you'll have to, you know, turn your pockets inside out and shrug. and they're not super forgiving about that, I guess, you know. I mean, obviously there's options. You'll have probably some kind of installment plan that you have to pay into and whatnot, but it's going to be a big headache that you can avoid otherwise. If you can just, like Richie's saying, figure out roughly what percentage of your income each month or however you want to work that gets separated out to, hey, hang on to this, don't touch it, it's for taxes.
Yeah, exactly. And then if you're conservative with it, then you can have a pleasant surprise when you file your taxes, and you can be like, hey, awesome, I don't owe as much as I thought. And then some of that can be spending money.
There you go.
Which is nice.
Kind of bonus.
Yeah, exactly. Kind of like what you might be used to if you over withhold on a paycheck, right? Yep. You get a refund, everyone loves their refunds, and all the other retail stores have all the, hey, come spend your refund here type advertisements and stuff like that. You still get that, just comes at you a little bit differently.
Now, and one of the other things that you talked about too, Richie, was deductions. And I want to make sure we touch on this too, because as someone who's self-employed with your own company, there are a lot of things that you are allowed to deduct for your company. If you're buying a new laptop for your company, you can deduct that as a business purchase, right? If you're buying software, if you have hosting that you're paying for, a domain name, you know, you buy Marmalead, that's all tax deductible because it's for your business, right? And there are these, you know, sometimes there's a little bit of a stigma about that, right? Where, you know, people think that if you take advantage of that, you were saying before, Richie, that people think that's a red flag, right? And the tax man kind of keys in on that, and that can cause issues for you. But no, that's not really the case. These things are in there for a reason, and they're in there to help people get started and really succeed with small businesses, because, you know, that's good for everybody. That's good for the economy, and that helps everything out. So these rules, and they're not even really loopholes, you know, they're in there for a reason to help out with stuff like that. So make sure you use those. Now, that said, you don't want to be overly aggressive with them, because then at that point, you know, it is going to be looked at kind of with a sideways hairy eyeball. But, you know, if you're smart about it you kind of pay attention to what's really allowed and what deducting, that's a really good way of not having to owe as much back to the government on taxes when you file your taxes.
Absolutely.
And like Richie was saying, if you're hiring someone to help you with the taxes, I would lean on them to help you understand what sorts of things could be tax deductible and things you can take advantage of, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Is this a good idea or not? Because they have these rules. That's basically, is it ordinary and necessary for your line of work? Right. And so tax professionals can be very used to this. And, you know, what you can justify in your head might be different than somebody is a professional there. One of the most common ones that is always villainized is home office deduction. People don't even have their own businesses. They're like, oh, home office deductions, it's going to get you audited. And it's like, really? Well, why would that be? But there's also like tons of other articles out there by accountants that are like, it's not like it's super villainized all the time, but it's really not that crazy. Unless you're out there like, oh yeah, 90% of my house is being written off as a home office. Well, that might be a little bit harder to swallow, right? But for the most part, you know, if you have a modest house and a home office deduction, like we're not talking a lot of tax savings. I don't think that you should take everything you're entitled to, obviously, right? So don't think, well, it's not a lot, so I'm just going to leave it on the table. Well, let's say it's $200. Is the IRS really going to send somebody out to audit your house and make sure that your office really takes up, a 10 by 10 room that like is your third bedroom to save $200? Highly unlikely. Highly unlikely that they're going to be like, that person is lying. You know, we're going to go recoup that money, take pictures and see that they're not really in a home office. Chances are if you have, actual business income and you are claiming a normal size home office, it's probably true.
They know what's realistic for the size of a home office and a house, right? And so if you're being realistic about it and reporting it realistically, there's really not going to be any problem with that either. One of the other things they mentioned too in your home office size could be not only where you're actually working and where you're crafting, where you're on your computer working, but where you keep your supplies. So don't forget about storage space and stuff like that too, which they specifically remind you of, at least in TurboTax when you're filling out your taxes, that those sorts of spaces are tax deductible as well. And to jump back here a little bit, you know, we're throwing out percentages. What a home office deduction really is you measure the amount of square footage that your office space or your workspace for your company can take up inside of your house. And you figure that as a percentage of your entire livable square footage of your house. And then that percentage of your house, whatever it ends up being, right, 5-10%, whatever it is, you can take that portion of other home expenses like your internet, like your electricity, like your water bills, your sewage, all that kind of stuff can then be deducted at that same percentage, right? So you can't claim all of your electric bill for your home office, but realistically, 10% of your home is your office. And so it uses, roughly 10% of the energy that the rest of your house would use. So you can deduct that as part of your business expenses.
Yes. And if you have a mortgage, like the mortgage and interest, stuff like that, homeowners insurance, percentage of that, all that fun stuff.
So that pretty much covers it. That pretty much covers it.
Yeah.
So one of the other things you're going to want to think about, in addition to medical expenses and taxes and all that kind of good stuff that we love thinking about on a day-to-day basis, is how much money you want to have saved up. Okay. So now this is kind of in addition to making sure that you can replace your current income for your standard of living that you want to maintain. You're going to probably want to have a little bit of a runway and have some money saved off, for like kind of a rainy day fund. You know, that if business is slow or something happens, you know, your hot water heater blows and you have these sudden expenses that all of a sudden come out of nowhere, you've got a little bit of money saved up for that. And what would you say is kind of the rule of thumb for that, Richie?
I would say that a lot of we'll call them experts, recommend something like 6 months. I've heard anything from 3 to 12 months, basically. Mm-hmm. And it depends on your situation, right? It depends on what you can cut back onto, right? Yeah. So the more you can scale back and the less you actually have to cover, well, the more months of runway you get.
Yeah.
If you're a two income household, you might already be living below your means and, if you lose one of the incomes, it's not really a big deal, right? So there's that situation. Mm-hmm. There's the single income supporting a whole family, right? Well, your appetite for risk on that might be a little bit different. And that definitely affects your runway as well.
Yeah.
So it really depends on where you're at and how comfortable you are and what other options you have if things don't work out.
Yep.
So
do you have a house payment? Do you have a car payment? Are you renting? All this kind of stuff.
Well, right. But let's say you have, you give yourself 6 months, but you're leaving a job that you think is going to take 12 months to replace. Well, then that's not enough, right? But if you have 6 months saved up and you think you can get yourself a job next week, mm-hmm. right? If you're like, oh, it didn't work. I need to go back. And you can
abort,
you know,
abort.
Right. If you have the type of thing where you can go like, you know, the next Monday, you'll be back in another company doing that job. Well, then you don't have to worry near as much. 6 months is way overkill. So it really depends on what you're in.
Yep.
So it's, you know, again, this is probably the one where it's more personal than any of the other options because it really depends on what you're comfortable with. The last thing you want to do is something that you're not comfortable with.
Yeah.
Well, I'll take that back. Discomfort can be a motivator.
But stress is not good. So balance those.
There's two different kinds of stress. There's the negative stress and there's eustress. Eustress being the E-U-S-T-R-E-S-S stress, right? And that is positive stress. That's a motivating stress. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing, which is why I spend every penny every single month so I wake up the next day knowing I have to grow the business.
I think that's fantastic advice. And that brings us back to what we said at the top of the show of not to listen to what we're saying.
That was just a test, Gordon. Just a test. But it is an example of how you can set some stakes for yourself to keep yourself motivated as you keep going. And it does factor into, you know, again, like how comfortable are you with how much you have and what the opportunity is ahead of you? Now, you don't always get to choose the best time to, you know, go full on to your business. Your business might need you more now, right? Like you will get to a point, and I've heard this from, you know, plenty of other entrepreneurs who've done this a few times, and they'll say that, you know, you don't like, you're going to end up needing to go full time before you're ready to do so. Because things change, like your business can be demanding, right? So your business might need you full time. And you don't want to let your business suffer because you can't devote more time to it, right? In that case, you have to say, look, am I willing to give up this opportunity by not going full time? Because that could be a reality, right? So normally we look at, oh, what are we walking away from over here to go do the business? But really, what are we walking away from business-wise by not giving it the attention it needs, right? Are you willing to risk it not working simply because, you know, you're not willing to do it full time yet because it's not comfortable? And I think that's a less talked about aspect of it as well.
I think so too.
Yeah.
So keeping all of this in mind about, you know, kind of the planning aspect of it and making sure that you're doing what you're comfortable with, right? And even Richie's method of spending all of his money each month to maintain that good level of positive stress in his life. That
keeps you got to stay hungry.
To working, right? Yeah, you got to stay motivated. Keeping all that in mind, right? These are all ways that you can kind of maintain your sanity throughout this whole process, right? Because that's an important thing to do. Because when you're making this transition from something that might be very comfortable to you to something, even if you have it super planned out and you're comfortable with, you know, your financial plan and your reserve money, it can still be kind of stressful. And I'm not talking about the good stress either, right? This can be the bad kind of stressful, the non-you stress.
Absolutely.
So keeping your sanity is a very important thing. Very important thing.
It is really important. It is really important, regardless of who you are, really. Like, even the most stable of people, I am not qualifying myself as one of them. Maybe Gordon. You seem a lot more stable than I do, Gordon. But regardless of person, everyone goes through, you know, different stages, really, of, like, how they feel about things. And it's kind of like, you know, routine. Like, we are very habit and routine-based creatures, right? Like humans in general, we do well when that type of stuff works, right? That's why a lot of things in the world, like jobs are 9 to 5, stuff like that. Things are very standardized because we like routines. And when you leave let's call it a more structured environment, simply because, you know, everyone's doing it, right? Everyone's showing up at the 9 to 5. Everyone's having lunch at this time. Everyone's doing all these things. When you're working on your own, whether or not you leave the house, let's say you're just going to like another office even.
Yeah.
I guess maybe you'd have more people. But especially if you're working at home, you've got to maintain your sanity while you might be the only one around. Or maybe you just have your family around. So maintaining your sanity might be like, I need to make an effort to go work from a coffee shop once in a while. Now, if you make things physically, you probably can't bring your workshop with you, but you might be able to bring like a laptop with you and use that time to follow up on messages or, you know, do some digital type things that you can catch up on out there and just kind of, you know, surround yourself with people, get some of that background noise and get out of the house.
And this, I think this is something that you don't necessarily have to have a game plan for, kind of like the finances to feel more comfortable with this. But this is definitely something you're going to want to make sure you're aware of. And you're kind of keeping your finger on the pulse of your own personal sanity, where, you know, stress can come out in all kinds of different ways. But if you're aware of it and you're kind of monitoring it and you're thinking in the back of your mind, you know, this may be due to this or these changes or the fact that I haven't really established a routine for myself and I really do need to do that. I didn't think I needed one. In fact, I thought it'd be freeing not to have one, but I guess I'm finding that I need one. Just be aware of that so that you can correct those things when they're happening. One of the other things you're probably going to want to think about too is if, you know, you at your day job, you have any kind of fitness schedule, like maybe you're part of a gym or something like that. And over lunch on Wednesdays, you hit the gym. Even the amount of activity that you have at an office job where you're getting up to go to meetings, to go talk to people at their desks or in their offices.
Walking from your car.
Walking from your car. Yeah, if you're in downtown Cleveland, you could be walking miles to get to a reasonably priced parking lot.
You park further away than your house for some reason, and then you walk there.
Well, that's because you can charge people more to park in your driveway than you'd be paying to park somewhere else. And you end up, anyway, it's something to keep in mind too, right? Like your level of activity. And this is something you might not notice a whole lot at first, but again, keep it in the back of your mind and try to keep tabs on how you're feeling. You know, both sanity wise and physically wise, if your energy is drooping and you're not feeling like you have the same energy, well, it could just be because you're not used to kind of staying in the same place for a long period of time during the day. And you're used to, you know, walking into work, walking to lunch, walking to meetings, walking to your desk, walking back to your car, things like that.
Absolutely. Change is inevitable, and it doesn't mean it has to be a bad thing. You just have to be aware of it. So I'd recommend self-awareness more than anything, just like keeping a tab on things, right? So, you know, whether that be happiness level, just kind of like what things are affecting you and how you're feeling. I think that's important because, you know, things, you know, again, depending on your situation, things that, you know, your routine gets shaken up and things are different. Just like, you know, imagine yourself just going to get another job, right? Like whenever you leave a job and start a new job, there's always it's change, right? So things can make you feel uncomfortable. You get nervous about the new place. It's all the same thing. So if you've ever had a new job, which I'm expecting, if you're currently leaving, like thinking about leaving a job for this, then you, of course, have at least had one job. So, it, you know, you would know what that feeling feels like, right? It's a feeling of something new. Mm-hmm. It's exciting. It's nervous. Will they like me? All that fun stuff.
So, and while we were talking here too, Richie jotted down another thing on our list of topics to cover, which is affirmations. You want to chat a little bit about, I don't know, give me like a good overview of what an affirmation is for somebody who's not familiar with them.
All right. So, affirmations, or specifically self-affirmations, basically something you say, you can say this in the mirror, you can say this just, you know, while you're out and about, you can say it in your head, if you don't walk around like saying it out loud, but it's kind of reinforcing something you believe or want to believe, right? So, you know, I'm going to have a great day. Like if you walk around, if you decide, right? So again, you're affirming an affirmation, you are affirming something. I am going to have a great day. If you do this, you're going to have a better chance of actually having a great day. Because as things happen to you, it's not what happens to you, it's how you react to the things that happen to you. Some will say that when you're doing self-affirmations, you're putting good vibes out into the universe and then it'll return them. Regardless of how far you want to take the actual effects of self-affirmations, at the very least, saying something positive is going to make you feel more positive, right? So imagine yourself having like a really good conversation with somebody, a friend, family member, right? You have a really positive conversation. You talk about something really happy. You feel good, right? You're not looking at the negative things in life.
I mean, unless you're just a very sad, angry human being.
Oh, right. Then you're not going to feel those uplifting feelings. You're just going to feel angry that someone tried to make you feel better. But on the flip side, now, I know I'm sure you've talked to somebody like this, that you talk to this person and you just always feel more down about it. Because this is the person that has to point out, you know, the one cloud in an otherwise perfectly blue sky, right? Like, we've all come across that person, you know, oh, isn't today wonderful? Yes, except for this, right? Like, and it's like, oh, and you just kind of walk away feeling more negative. So it's kind of like having a positive conversation with yourself, I guess.
You know, it's interesting you bring that up too, because one of the articles I remember reading a long time ago was saying how that if you're embarking on this entrepreneurship path, one of the things you're really going to want to do and that's going to help out a lot is surrounding yourself with people who are positive and who aren't those kinds of people who point out the one dark cloud in the otherwise beautiful blue sky. So take that for what it's worth.
Absolutely. Yeah, a lot of people say you got to just completely cut them out.
I mean, unless it's like your mom. I mean, if it's your mom, you probably can't cut her out.
That would be more difficult.
You know what? If it's your mom, email Kevs, and I'm sure he can help out in some way, you know, and offer some solid advice with that.
Yeah, he can help with anything. So I'm sure he can help with that too.
Yeah. Perfect. He's good.
He's going to appreciate that you put him out there like that.
Oh, he told me to. He told me it was all right.
Oh, okay. Perfect.
So for any kind of reference here to affirmations, if you guys are familiar with Saturday Night Live and Daily Affirmations with Stuart Smalley, that's kind of what they are, right? That's kind of a tongue-in-cheek version of what the whole idea is behind affirmations. If anyone watches Mr. Robot, which is a fantastic TV show that's on right now, Angela recently has started doing affirmations in her role in season 2. So you've probably seen them elsewhere if you've seen either of those two things before.
Are they working?
So the Stuart Smalley one, it's hard to say. I mean, he's a very happy, positive guy, but they kind of pitch him as a little bit crazy. So that's more of a poking fun at the whole idea. And Angela, it's tough to say. She's enjoying success, but it could be at the expense of who she is. However, I don't think that's due to the affirmations. I just think that's due to where her character is right now in the show.
Okay, well, that's a nice little overview.
There you go.
So in short, they're working and you should do them.
Yeah, I mean, why not? At first, it might feel a little awkward to start saying them out loud. And you can start by like just repeating them to yourself in your head if that you're more comfortable doing that. But try to say them out loud, because it's kind of crazy feeling when you do that and you start saying these things out loud. And you know, I don't think that they're going to directly make good things happen to you because you're saying them, but like Richie's saying, it puts you in a positive frame of mind and lots of little things are going to start happening that are more positive rather than like maybe something big. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yep. When you look for the positive, more positive things seem to happen. Sure. And if you look for negative things, more negative things seem to happen.
And when that happens, it can feel like a roller coaster.
It sure can. Specifically, I came across a while ago, it described as the entrepreneur life cycle. And it's this roller coaster that you go through as an entrepreneur. And I have changed the order from which it was originally presented just because I felt like this order was a better fit.
It's a much better order.
Gordon thinks it's a better order as well.
It's Richie's order. And while we are not experts, it's definitely better than whoever wrote the article to begin with. some rando.
Yeah, perfect. Now we can't identify them. So it starts out with unfounded optimism, right? So this is when you're first starting it out. Of course, your idea. You wouldn't work on it if you didn't think it was a good idea, right? So you put your energy into it, and you're like, this is fantastic. I don't really have a reason to think it's fantastic. It's not like you have numbers to believe it's fantastic right now. But for some reason, you believe it is a fantastic idea, as you should, because that's the only only way any new ideas are going to get going is if someone believes in them.
Yeah.
And actually, everyone shouldn't believe in it, because if everyone believes it's a great idea right from the start, number one, it's probably been done, or there's a really good reason it hasn't, right? So it's good to go against the grain at that point.
You need to niche down.
Yes. But at some point, you're going to be like, you know what? This is a good idea, right? So things are going well. You know, the numbers are starting to show me this. And then you're going to find yourself with, something's not going as well as I thought. So now I'm going to be kind of pessimist about it, right? So I'm unfounded pessimism. And it could be just little things, right?
Yeah.
But at some point, you look around and be like, that wasn't there before and I don't like it. And it's an omen, right? It's an omen. Something's wrong. I don't like it. I can't really put my finger on it, but things are going downhill.
It could just be things aren't meeting up to your expectations. You know, you have your idea that you've got these cool things that you can make. You make a bunch of them. You take photos. You do a bunch of work. You set up your first Etsy shop. You list them out there, and an hour goes by, and you still don't have your first sale.
Or someone was mean to you. One person was mean to you.
Or somebody saw them and made them and listed them and are selling them themselves now and apparently has thousands of sales.
That's more like founded pessimism, though. So unfounded is more like, you know, one person was mean to you and then said your stuff was crap and your prices were too high. And you're like, oh my gosh, the world hates everything I do. And it's like, no, that was just one person who clearly didn't do a good job of keeping their own sanity, as we talked about earlier. And then founded pessimism, maybe a few more people don't like what you're doing and you take that a little bit more to heart. And then like Gordon said, someone copies your product and then they get thousands of sales. You're like, what did they do? What did I do wrong? Right. Then you have this, it's also known as the crisis of meaning state, right? You're like, why do I even do this? What is the point? Right. This is a dark time.
Yeah. This was a dumb thing to make. Why did I make this? I should have made something different. People don't want to buy this.
And this is also the point where you're at a fork in the road. You can either keep going with your business and address it, identify and, you know, be self-aware of what's going on and be like, okay, so I'm feeling down about these specific things. Can I fix them? Can I change them? Or do they honestly even matter in the grand scheme of things?
Yeah.
And you can do that, or you can not be self-aware and you can just kind of crash and burn.
Yeah. I would be really unfortunate. Watch Netflix for a few weeks.
That might not fix your problem, but if you do fix your problem, you'll pretty much go back through the cycle and you go back to unfounded optimism. You'll find something, you'll find a bright spot, and then you go chase that. And then that again will turn into founded optimism. You just kind of keep going.
So you run out of energy.
Yeah. So you run out of energy.
Or money.
I think the most important thing about the lifestyle cycle is just knowing that, being self-aware again, that you're going to go through this and it's okay, regardless of where you're at and how you're feeling, whether or not you're feeling very euphoric or you're feeling, you know, very down. It's okay. It's okay to have feelings. It's okay to go up and down. And it's perfectly normal. Even the most stable of people are going to go through these feelings.
Yeah.
They're probably not sharing them with you. So it's hard to know how many other people out there, like in your life, are having these same feelings, right? And these same up and downs, because we don't typically talk about it.
Right. Right. Yeah. I mean, that's exactly the point. I think that it's a roller coaster, but the whole idea here is that somebody took the time to actually document the different phases of this and give them names. Like, this is a common thing. People are going through this all the time. And some of the highs might not be, you know, as high, and some of the lows might not be quite as low. But it's a thing, and there's going to be ups, there's going to be downs. It's going to be a roller coaster. And it's good when you're having those euphoric moments, right? And you're super optimistic about how things are going and you know, maybe even sales are up and stuff like that. It's good to keep yourself a little bit grounded and keep in mind like, hey, I'm on this roller coaster still. I just happen to be at the top of a hill right now, or on my way up a hill, hopefully, right? And the hill keeps going. That'd be even better. but to keep yourself a little bit grounded there, because you're probably going to have another little downhill moment, right? And that's okay, because that's yep. that's what happens. And when you're having the downhill moment, or you're at the bottom of the hill, it's good to keep this in mind too, so that you can think forward to getting yourself out of that hill, or knowing that, you know, in time, if I watch enough Netflix, it's going to be over. This hill's going to be over. It can't be that big of a valley. Maybe it takes 5 months of Netflix, but I'll get through it.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't really matter where you are on the map. As long as you know where you are, you're not lost, right? So it's important just to know where you are.
Yeah.
So identify where you are on the stage, and then you can find your way out of it. You can navigate from there. The scariest thing would be if you have no idea where your bearings are.
That's right. Again, this kind of goes back to, you know, what we were talking about earlier with keeping your sanity. And, you know, kind of keep your finger on your own pulse here so that you're aware of, you know, how you're feeling about this kind of stuff.
That's true.
Don't let it cripple you.
Definitely not.
Which brings us to time management.
That's a good one. What do you want to say about time management?
I want to say that it's important. So, you know, as you're working as an employee for somebody else, time management is oftentimes kind of pressed upon you. You know, you're expected to be at work at a certain time. You're expected that your lunch hour can be between this time and this time. And then you're expected to stay at work until a certain time. And meetings are scheduled, right? You have to be at the meeting, and then you have so much time in the morning to check emails and what, you know, whatever have you. All of this time stuff is kind of impressed upon you. And, you know, you're still left to manage the, usually, anyway, depends on your job, but you're usually left to manage the parts of your day in between those meetings and between lunch and arriving at work and leaving to go home and whatnot. Now, when you're working from home, it depends really on how you have things set up. And maybe, you know, if you're doing stuff around with your family and whatnot, maybe some things are scheduled there, like if you have to pick up the kids from school or drop the kids off at school. But overall, your day is going to be a whole lot more wide open. And there's going to be a lot fewer people telling you, you need to be doing this from this time to this time and this from this time to that time. But like Richie was saying earlier, people are you know, routine oriented, and most people thrive in an environment where something is more routine. So it's going to be up to you to come up with your own schedule, your own time management, your own methods and tools and way that you want to break that down. But, you know, keep yourself honest about it, right? And find what works best for you. I work better at night, right? So I'm not a morning person. Like, yes, I get up early with my family, but I don't like mornings. It takes a cup of coffee to like kind of help that along, right? I'm much more of a night owl than a morning person. I would stay up till like 3 a.m. every night if I could, and then sleep until noon. That would be awesome. But that's just not, that's not going to help anybody. So things like that. Keep that in mind, and when you're going to work best and when you have time to do things, maybe you find that you're more creative at certain points of the day than other times during the day. And so you want to schedule certain work to happen during those more creative points in your day. You know, maybe you've got a point in the day where like there's a TV show or something that's on that you really want to watch, but you know, if you sit down to watch the TV show, you can get this other stuff done while you're watching TV. Well, that's cool. Like, schedule that at the same time and kind of keep yourself honest, with your time management.
Yeah. I mean, since you're in control of it, you can try all sorts of things. You can try experiments, because there's a lot of documentation that says, and I think a lot of it's based on, what, like relation to when you woke up. So a lot of it's like, you know, oh, from 1 to 2, you're, you know, best at doing this kind of activity. Or like in the mornings, you're best at doing like analytical like activities. Yep. I don't think that's necessarily morning. I think it's more of in relation to when you woke up. So like this many hours into when you've woken up, like you're better at these things. But again, these are broad what studies found. It doesn't mean that it's, you know, effective to you. Yep. What I would take away from it is there is probably truth to it, that you yourself are probably better at certain types of activities at certain points of your day. And since you control your day when you work for yourself, you can try all sorts of different experiments and see what really works. But it also means, you know, that you have to have a lot of self-control and not do things like spend your whole day on Facebook or watching Netflix and saying, that's all right, work will be there tomorrow. Right. 'Cause if you do that enough, it won't be.
Or it will be, but not in the form that you really want it to be.
Right. You're like, oh, crap.
Back here again.
How does this keep happening? In that case, if that does happen, you need to email Gordon, actually, and have him set up some blockers on your network so you can't get to some of these websites. Yep. He'll come up with a password.
We won't tell you.
A really secure password. Nice won't tell you. Nice filter. Keep you away from all the distractions.
Yeah. It's funny. You kind of joke about that, but there are applications, especially for writers, for people who are writing, that are purely designed to minimize distractions. It shuts all kinds of stuff down, and it gives you your nice blank screen with zero distractions. We've gotten so used to, on our computers, things popping up all the time, whether it's like a Facebook or an email or Twitter. I mean, there's so many things that are competing for our attention and wanting us to form habits with them that it becomes really hard to carve out time during your day to just sit down, you know, put on the blinders and get done whatever you need to get done.
Actually, I was just listening to an interview of Neil Strauss, who's written like a bunch of different New York Times bestsellers. And one of the things he does is he uses an app on his computer, something, I think it's called like Freedom or something like that. And it basically disables all this, all the internet stuff and all the things that are distracting, and lets him focus on writing. And then he takes his phone and he gives it to somebody else.
Yeah.
He said, you can put it in a drawer or something like that, but it's best to just give it to somebody else. So, you know, if you do have someone else you can give it to, like, just get those things out of the way. Cause if it's here, right, if it's in your pocket and you know, you're getting emails, also turn notifications off your phone. So even for the times you have your phone, don't let it send push notifications of everything, because you're going to constantly look at your phone to see what's going on. So don't let your use it as a tool, but don't let it own you.
Yeah, I don't know about Androids, but at least on iPhones, there's a feature called Do Not Disturb. And you can put your phone into Do Not Disturb mode where things won't show up and disturb you. But if you have somebody who's set to like an important emergency contact and they try to contact you for whatever reason, you know, their call will still get through to you. So that's probably kind of why he was thinking maybe give it to a friend or somebody else, so
you don't have to worry about it.
Act as a filter, but then at least if someone really needs something, you can still be kind of aware of it. Whereas if you just shut it off completely, you know, you're not gonna catch something in case something actually important does happen during that point in time. But
and if you do it every single day, right, which you should, like at some point you will miss something important, right? Whether it's be someone like, you know, their car won't start, they need to jump, something like that. Someone will call you with something important at some point in the years that you're doing this practice if you just turn off your phone. So that's the biggest problem for me of doing something like not doing Do Not Disturb, like turning your phone completely off. That is, you know,
I mean, the upside of that though, but is if that happens enough and somebody is asking you for like a jump enough times and you ignore them, they'll probably stop being your friend and then they won't be asking you urgent things anymore.
That might be a problem if it's your wife though, because then she'll stop being wife and then, you know, that.
Yeah, well, I mean, especially if she's the one with the medical insurance. Yeah.
Wait, she's taking that too? They can do that?
Yes. So time management.
That's what happens if you don't manage your time. Stay off Facebook or that's going to happen.
This is true. And it's so easy to look back, you know, on a day where I haven't really set goals for myself or carved out certain times during the day that I'm going to sit down and get stuff done. It's so easy to get to the end of the day and be like, what did I do today? You know, I didn't get any of the things done that I wanted to get done today. What the heck did I do all day? And I know that happens to people all the time. I mean, it's just a fact of life. It's just interruptions in the way things get in. And so unless you're making the time to make things happen, they're not going to happen.
No. Because yesterday you said tomorrow.
Oh, God, not this again. We'll work on that one for next episode. We'll get it.
One of these episodes will take it.
Tomorrow's it. Wait, no.
It's got to be your yesterday.
It's going to be yesterday's episode. So, yeah.
But, yeah. So, if you don't have a plan, you plan to fail. That's kind of one of those cliches that they throw out there. But it's pretty much true. Like,
there you go.
The world we live in right now, everything is constantly beeping and buzzing for your time. Quite literally, right? Yeah. Like, it seems the new thing on the desktop right now is push notifications in your browser. So everything wants to enable push notifications. So no matter where I am, as long as I'm in my browser, which is pretty much where everyone works now, just like if you're looking at your phone, things are just popping up everywhere to let you know but every little thing that happens.
Sure.
And it's insane.
Yeah. It means more attention for them. It means more of your time spent on their sites. It means more data that they can collect. It means more ads they can serve up and get seen and more revenue they can bring in. I mean, there's all kinds of motivations behind it, and probably not that many of them actually have your best interests in mind.
No, you have to really
think. I mean, unless we start doing notifications with Marmalead, and then we really do have your best interests in mind.
That's right.
Yeah.
In all seriousness, we would, though, if we did something like that, we would.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We don't want to steal your time, right? We want to give you back time.
Yes, exactly. Like when you use a tool, it should be very, a very deliberate action. You should be doing whatever you're doing at all, tool, not tool, whatever you're doing, it should be the best use of your time. Like you should actually like deliberately have chosen to do this thing. Mm-hmm. Even if that's sitting down and watching 30 minutes of Netflix. I know that some people actually plan that in their day, just like, I'm going to force myself to decompress for 30 minutes while I'm eating lunch. I'm going to watch Netflix so that I don't explode later. Right. Yep. Like they just, that's part of their own sanity, their own self-awareness. Like sometimes people can just, you know, you burn the candle at both ends, you burn out and you're not useful. And if you recognize that pattern, break the pattern. And if that's what it takes, but just realize that, you know, 30 minutes on Facebook can turn into 3 hours on Facebook kind of stuff. And you just want to make sure that you're really deliberate in whatever you're doing. Mm-hmm. Whatever you're doing, is it the most productive, most effective thing you can do with your time in your role? Because when, you know, you're going at it alone, like you're wearing 1,000 hats. So, you know, just because this thing can get done, should it get done?
Right.
You're going to have to answer that for yourself.
Yeah.
And if you do this, what are you not doing? That's probably the most important question.
Yeah. Yeah. You know,
if I do this, what else am I not doing?
Keep your goals in mind and think long, like down the road, right? Like what are the end goals here? And if, you know, working on Twitter and sending a bunch of tweets out doesn't help get me toward that goal, or I haven't seen any evidence that it helps get me toward that goal, is it the best use of my time? Could I be doing something different? Could I be redoing my photos? Could I be redoing my descriptions? Does that help? Should I be coming up with other products, right? What has worked in the past and what should I be spending my time on that's going to get me where I need to be? Not just like kind of busy stuff that seems to eke into our lives so easily.
Agreed. 100% agreed.
So, and kind of in that same vein, right? The whole idea of entrepreneurship and being an entrepreneur, mompreneur, right? Dadpreneur. I've heard so many cool words for it. Whatever you want to call it. That whole thing, it's really a mindset. It's really a mindset of all of these things that we've just talked about, of kind of keeping tabs on yourself, you know, planning things out so that you're comfortable where you're at, knowing that the thing, that everything can be a roller coaster, knowing that there's going to be ups and downs, but the whole thing is really a mindset, and the mindset of staying focused on those goals that you have for yourself, you know, like we're talking about in this episode, leaving a full-time job. I mean, that's a pretty clear goal right there, right? I mean, we talk about SMART goals. Like, that's probably got all the qualities right there. It's replacing your salary. You've defined a time frame and everything. So you've kind of got your goal set up for you there. But entrepreneur mindset is keeping focused on that and keeping motivated and doing the hustle, hustling so hard toward that goal.
I feel like you just stopped in your tracks right there.
I was waiting for you to jump in, man.
Yes. I just felt like mid-sentence. I'm sorry. I was like, wow, Gordon's really going right now. This is fantastic. And then it just kind of stopped. Like, wait a minute.
I don't know. I kind of ran out of stuff to say, and I was like, Richie's going to save me.
I'm sorry.
It's all right.
It was good, though. I enjoyed that. And it is all about a mindset. A lot of the things we talked about come right back into the mindset, right? Like keeping your sanity, make sure that like you have like the fuel in the tank to do the things you got to do. Knowing where you're at in this entrepreneur life cycle, doing the affirmations, time management, right? Like these things are going to help you in that mindset. But some of it is a sort of like really core. Like you just have to work hard. You have to hustle. You have to really know where to focus this energy. And there are going to be days where you don't have as, you know, you're like, yeah, I'm all about hustle today. And then tomorrow you're tired, right? Like it happens. That's normal.
But get back on it.
But get back at it. Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. And you see different people out there. Like, let's talk about Gary Vaynerchuk, right? That dude looks tired sometimes. He'll never admit it. He'd probably yell at me for saying he looks tired sometimes, but he'll also talk about, he'll jump on Snapchat and be like, I just finished a 20-hour day. Right. Yeah. Like,
yeah.
And it's like 3 a.m. And it's like, yeah, dude, you look a little bit tired right now.
He's crazy, man. He is all about the hustle. I was watching an interview with him on a podcast where he was talking about how he does all of his own social media stuff, and he keeps up with, like, you know, Twitter and all of his different accounts that he has all over the place. And the host is interviewing him. He's like, how do you keep up with that? Because it is such a time sink for so many people. And he's like, well, I just wrote like 12 tweets while I was doing this interview with you. Like, what? I don't know. I couldn't do that, but I mean, he can, and that's how he hustles. And that's incredible to me. Like, I can't do two things at once like that. I couldn't carry on a conversation and tweet something. I mean, my wife could even tell you that, right? She knows that better than anyone else. If I'm on my phone, I'm not listening. So, but it's all about the hustle. It's all about keeping up those efforts, because one of Richie's favorite things to talk about is how your competition doesn't want you to do that, right? Your competition wants you to watch Netflix for 5 months straight.
That's correct.
Your competition wants you to give up. They want you to get discouraged. Your competition wants you to not hustle. They want you to get distracted by all these things. They want you to not manage your time well and spend all of your money every month so that you keep up that positive stress level in your life. Your competition wants you to not do well. And so that's why you have to keep up the hustle, because there's always going to be competition out there. No matter what you're doing, there's going to be other people competing with you.
Absolutely. Yeah. So don't ever think like, oh, it's just too competitive right here, and like, I go over here where there's no competition.
Yeah.
No, the only place with no competition is a failure, right? Like, I guess if you go somewhere that's just like full of a bunch of failures, like, they won't compete with you because they're all too broken to compete, right?
But
that's the
harder.
Only place.
I failed right? Way harder than you.
And if you look at some of these, well, actually a lot of the content, the videos that Gary Vaynerchuk puts out, right? Like, he is maximizing like every moment of his time. A lot of his videos are him on his way to do something else. He's walking out of a business meeting and he's being filmed giving people advice that's going up on the internet, right? Like all of his social media accounts. Yeah. He's getting into a car. He takes Uber everywhere so he doesn't have to drive and stuff like that. And he's being videoed while he's there. So like every moment, whatever he's doing, he's making use of that to promote him forward.
And that guy has a crazy amount of energy. If you've ever seen any videos or conversations with him, I mean, it's so obvious. He looks like he drinks coffee nonstop. He must have like an IV of coffee or something like that going into it, because he's got an insane amount of energy.
And he's happy. He's a happy dude. He's a really happy guy, and I think it's because he gives it his all, and he knows he leaves nothing on the table every day, right? So he doesn't have to wonder if. I also think, aside from him just having a lot of energy, I think he uses more of that energy than most people. I think most people think they've had enough, or they're tired, they've put it enough in, way before they've given it everything, right? Kind of like treading water, right? You see stories about people that were out on a boat and they treaded water for like 48 hours or something like that. And I can't do it for like 4 minutes.
Yeah.
I like bet if I was out
water.
Right. But I bet the person, myself, who's like, yeah, I don't want to even do it for 4 minutes. If it was life or death, you could, right? You'd use a lot more energy. You're going to drain yourself way further down. I think that's something that he does. He just knows that, you know, most people take themselves to like maybe like half tank. He's driving it like it's saying E, and he laughs at it. I know you have a reserve. There's some fumes in there.
I'm going to swerve a little bit.
No, turn it off one, coast a little while, and turn it back on.
Put it in neutral and turn off the AC.
Actually, Mitch used to do that.
That probably Mitch, helped a little bit.
When Mitch would get to his street, he would turn off, he'd put it in neutral and turn off his car and coast to the driveway.
It's kind of funny. There's a highway near us in the peninsula, and if you get off of the highway, off of the exit ramp, and you put your car in neutral and take that road all the way down into the valley where Peninsula is, beautiful town, by the way. You can do it. You can stay in neutral, and the speed limit even changes. And because of the way the hills are up and down and everything, it just works out that like you pretty much stay going the correct speed until you get to the bottom of the hill, at which point you always need to give it gas to get back up the hill. So at this point in the podcast, Richie and I proceeded to talk for the next hour or so about things that really probably don't matter to you guys. So I did you a favor and I cut that out. And then Richie's toilet proceeded to overflow, which I will share with you. Yeah, we should probably like roll this back in.
We have big problems.
What did she do?
We have big problems.
Oh! Toilet's overflowing.
Oh no, dude. All right.
What happened, Lila?
She pulls the handle like six times.
Lila! This is going everywhere!
Hey, it's all the way out here!
I see that!
Make it stop!
I'm trying to make it stop!
This is gonna be fantastic content.
What the hell's wrong with this place?
What is going on?
You guys are on the top floor of your apartment, right?
Yeah, totally. Lila, she thinks it's hilarious. She's never done this before. Did she, like...
Did
she flush a bunch of toilet paper?
It looks like it.
It sure looks like it.
Damn it, kid. Seriously. What's up, Mom? Mom, what's up, Mom?
You're gonna ruin the floor. Move.
This is gold.
Why? You guys can go ahead.
And you thought we ran out of content.
All about the roller coaster. Richie's just at the bottom of a hill right now.
Nothing goes up from here. It's all uphill from here, Gordon.
Because yesterday you said it was uphill.
Or it's downhill better.
Oh, yeah. Is it all downhill? It's all uphill from yesterday.
She completely flooded this.